Oh, dear. Wherever you go in the countryside these days, it seems to be full of this stuff. I used to think that rubbish was mostly paper, but not anymore. It's this. It's plastic. It's all over the place, and it looks so ugly. I know we use a lot of plastic every day, but once it's thrown away, like out here, it never seems to disappear. I wonder why that is.
It's now high summer, but the plastic rubbish swept down by the winter floods is still here on the riverbank. It hasn't rotted away. It'll be around for years.
You know, we've heard of the Stone Age, the Iron Age, and the Age of the Railways. Well, there's a strong argument to call the age that you and I live in the Plastic Age. Have you ever counted how many plastic objects we touch in that very first half hour after waking up? Well, if not, why don't you count them now? Well, how many did you count? Well, I counted 21 plastic objects that those children touched. But I'm sure they touched many more. What about that carpet or the plastic tablecloth? Well, yes, that's something to think about, isn't it? Well, why don't you count how many plastic things there are in your classroom? I'm sure you'll be surprised how many there really are all around you. But you know, when your parents were at school, say about 30 years ago, there were very few plastic objects in the classroom then. But when your grandparents were children, I don't suppose there were any plastic objects around at all.
But there weren't many motor cars around then either. Could there be a connection between cars and plastics, I wonder?
For years, I'm told, the only plastic around was a material called bakelite. Hard and shiny stuff. That's very like the plastic which is still used for bits and pieces in the car and to cover the electrical equipment. But where did it come from? And what about the many new types of materials? Polythene and polystyrene? Where have they come from?
And what is the connection between plastics and a petrol station? Yes, you've guessed it. The link is oil. Oil is taken out of the earth in huge quantities all over the globe. From the North Sea to the Persian Gulf, from Texas to Alaska to Nigeria, oil is drilled. It's brought by pipeline and tanker to huge factories. Oil refineries. Here, the crude oil, straight from the bowels of the earth, is refined. It's turned into petrol and many other products as well, including plastics. No wonder plastics and motor cars have grown up together.
This kitchen is a long, long way from being an oil refinery or a chemical plant. But I can do something to this egg that's very similar to what happens to oil in a huge refinery. Ugh, what a mess. It's a pity I didn't drop this one. And you know why? Well, because it's a boiled egg. It's hard and it behaves very differently to a fresh egg. And look at that egg over there. It's a fried egg. And if I add something to it, milk in this case, I have scrambled egg. And that's very different in taste, look and texture to any other egg. But it's still an egg, isn't it?
The making of plastics from oil is a very complicated chemical process. In works which look as if they've been built of silver pipes. And this one at Barry in South Glamorgan makes the raw material for a great variety of plastic products. In the laboratory, the chemist can show us what goes on in the huge plant nearby, but he does so on a very much smaller scale. He's also made everything simpler for us. But it's still the same process. A chemical which comes from oil is heated in a flask, and something happens to it. Just watch. It's changed in at least two ways, hasn't it? Do you remember the egg? Well, by heating it or adding something to it, it changed its shape and its texture. And the same is true of oil. This is crude oil that's come from the North Sea, but it could have come from Texas, Venezuela, or even the Middle East. This crude oil then goes through a number of different changes at an oil refinery, and then arrives here at Barry like this, a liquid, a clear liquid called styrene. The styrene is then heated, and things are added to it. Remember that egg? And makes polystyrene. And here at Barry, hundreds of tons of it are produced every month. Polystyrene is made here as little white granules. But at the next factory they go to, they'll be changed again into all sorts of other products. Things which we'll all recognise. There'll be no sign of those granules then, but they'll be there, inside 100 colourful plastic products, all of them tracing their family back to oil. I know you'll recognise some of these everyday things as they come off the production line. Here they come, just a few of the many, many useful things that are made from polystyrene. Have a guess what these can be. They're all plastic, every bit. These household things are made in one factory at Swansea, and there are other factories that are making millions of plastic goods all over the world. A world of plastic.
We're so spoilt, you know. Most of us by now just couldn't get by if we couldn't use all those useful things that have been made from plastic. What would I use if I couldn't use a biro? And what would I wear on a rainy day if I couldn't wear my anorak? And they've all been made from oil. And without oil, life would be very, very different. But if we don't use oil and plastics properly, they can be such a menace, as we've seen so many times.
Oil is carried around the world in 1,000 tankers, and most of the time, it arrives safely. But when it doesn't, it comes ashore with dreadful results. This happened 20 years ago, and you can see how little could be done then to help the little creatures covered by the oil. There followed a long line of similar disasters. Fires at sea, tankers being holed and leaking oil. Sometimes lives were lost, but always the wildlife of the sea and of the coastline suffered, and they are still suffering. These poor little sea otters in Alaska are only the latest casualties of oil spillage at sea. And we seem as helpless to save them now as we were 20 years ago. Oh, it's a sad story. In Alaska, everything was tried to stop the oil from spreading. Everything failed. It was sprayed with chemicals from the air with little success. It still came ashore and caused great damage to the life of the sea and of the coast. And all the rubbish thrown up by the sea on our beaches is, in a way, part of the same problem. It can't be easily got rid of, and often it's a great danger to wildlife. Plastic things like this are so incredibly useful. We use them every day and throw them away. But they can be very dangerous to birds, animals, and fish. Seabirds are such free, active creatures. You'd think they'd be safe from the plastic rubbish we throw away so carelessly. But look at these young gulls. One of them is wearing a collar of plastic. And you know what its end is bound to be, don't you?
So So what can be done? Well, not a great deal, I'm afraid, other than making sure that we look after all those plastic things after we've used them. You see, plastic is so cheap. You wouldn't expect to get your money back on that plastic bottle, would you? But we could start thinking about using paper cups instead of plastic cups, just as they've been doing on those ferries across the channel recently. I know that's something very small, but at least it's one step in the right direction, isn't it? And recycling plastic things is so expensive, so not many factories recycle these days. So instead of recycling, we should start thinking about reusing. We could reuse that plastic cup, after washing it, of course, and we could reuse a plastic bottle. And some people have thought of some very different ideas about reusing things. What about turning two plastic washing up containers into a battery-driven power wagon? Or make a rocket out of a plastic bottle, as they've done at Glenaman School. But this horrible waste by the riverbank shows that we're not looking after our plastics properly. Throwing it away doesn't get rid of it. Just try to find out how long plastic takes to rot. The masses of it on the landfill tip is in the right place, but it's going to be there forever. Oh dear, why can't plastic behave like other materials?
How strong are various types of plastic? That's what we've had a lot of fun measuring.
And we've been busy making posters to show how dangerous it can be when plastic is thrown carelessly away.
And in our garden, we've shown there are use even for the smallest plastic sheet. It makes a great weed killer and doesn't damage anything else in the soil, especially the animals that live in it.